The parable of the talents. Jesus used the parable of the talents to illustrate the importance of not only being prepared for his second coming as it deals with our salvation, but also to be prepared for his judgment on how we used our talents and giftedness for his kingdom. This will be an examination by the only true and righteous judge of how we invested, listen to this, how we invested what he entrusted to us for his kingdom purposes. And not only will we be judged on how we use those gifts, but also what our motives were in using them. Did we do everything for his glory, or did we do it for our own personal gain? So as we look at this parable, understand that this parable views each of our lives in relationship to Christ as well as our loyalty and service to him. So without further ado, let's open our Bibles to Matthew chapter 25, verses 14 through 30. Let's dive in. As the parable opens in verse 14, Jesus compares the kingdom of heaven to a man traveling into a far country who calls his own servants and delivered to them his goods. Now, the time mentioned here where the man will be traveling to a far country represents the time frame from when the Lord ascended to heaven after his second resurrection and his return at his second coming. And so the people Jesus was speaking to in this parable understood this analogy, as it was quite customary, if you will, for a man to turn his property over to a servant who would handle his business for him in his absence. And so, and then in verse 15, as we look, after he called in these three servants, he distributed a measure of talents to each one. Scripture says to one, he gave five talents. To another, two talents, and to another, one talent. So what is a talent? Well, a talent here represents a sum of money, which could vary in its value depending on the time and history. A talent was a weight of money varying from about around 60 to 80 pounds, if you will. Now, according to scholars, a silver talent varied in value from $1,000 to $2,000, while a gold talent could be worth more than $30,000. Nevertheless, most scholars believe that these talents here were silver talents and that they were worth about $2,000 a piece. But if they were gold talents, if you will, they would have been worth about $30,000 a piece. That's a lot of money. And so in either case, these servants, as you can see, were entrusted with something of great value. They were entrusted with something of great value. To put it in perspective, if you will, the five talent man, if they were gold talents, received $150,000. Or if silver talents, it would be $10,000. The two talent man may have received as much as 60,000 talents if they were, or $60,000 if they were gold talents, and 4,000 if they were silver. And likewise, the one talent man, 30,000 for a gold talent, or 2,000 if they were silver talents. But the important thing, however, is to not focus too much on whether the talents were gold or silver, but to understand that to the master, what he entrusted to these servants, listen to this again, was very valuable. And if you look closely at verse 15, there is something Jesus mentioned here that is very important not to miss. And that is that the talents were distributed to each servant based on each one's individual ability. This is important for a number of reasons. First, God is never going to ask you to do anything that he knows you don't have the ability to do. Listen to what the psalmist writes in Psalm 139, 14 through 15. He says, I will praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Marvelous are your works, and that my soul knows very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in secret and skillfully wrought in the lowest parts of the earth. Now, did you hear that? You and I are not only fearfully and wonderfully made, but skillfully made by God. He skillfully created you and I with certain gifts and gave each one of us different abilities. Think about that. God knew each of us before we were even born and created and put us here for this very time we are now living in. We were born and gifted to live in this time period for a specific reason. And therefore, God expects us to use our talents within our God-given abilities for his kingdom work. Now, 1 Peter 4:10 says, as each has received a gift, use it to serve one another. The New King James says, minister to one another as good stewards of the manifold grace of God. So the important thing not to miss is that every one of us has been entrusted with at least one gift, and we are expected to be good stewards and use whatever God has given to us for his purpose. Also, another important thing to remember is that we are not to compare ourselves with others. How God chose to equip others and to use them is up to him. It's up to God alone. God wants us to focus on our own unique abilities and use the talents entrusted to us to bring him glory and to grow his kingdom. You see, we shouldn't be jealous of someone else's ability or talents and find ourselves trying to be like them. We cannot do something with excellence that God has not equipped us to do. We are to live within our own ability and our uniqueness while working with others who are also using their unique ability for God's kingdom purposes. Paul reminds us of this very thing in Romans 12:4 when he says, "For as we are many members in one body, but all members do not have the same function." That means that each one of us as God's children needs to focus on our God-given talents and use them within our God-given ability. That is how great things are accomplished for the kingdom. When everyone uses their own unique talents within their own God-given ability, working together in harmony with others, God's will and purposes can be accomplished. But if we find ourselves always desiring to do something God never intended for us to do, it will lead us not only to a lack of contentment, but also take us away and distract us from how God really desires to use us. You and I must never forget this. We must never forget that we should never question God about what he chose to entrust us with. But we are to be faithful in taking and using whatever he entrusted us with for his glory and his glory alone and his purposes. And that is hard to do a lot of times. It's hard to do when we are focused on doing something we are not called or equipped to do. So the challenge for all of us is this. Make sure you are in the center of God's will. Locked into your uniqueness that came from him and him alone, and then use the talents you've been entrusted with to the best of your God-given ability. And if you do that, not only will you be a good steward, but you will also find lasting contentment in being all God created you to be. And that is what we see from the servant who was given the five talents. He went and used his God-given ability and invested those five talents and ended up making five more talents. And the same is true of the servant who was entrusted with the two talents. He used his God-given ability and invested those two talents and ended up making two more talents. But then we see something drastically different from the servant who was given just the one talent. He went and dug a hole and hid his talent. In other words, he did nothing with what the master had given him. And unfortunately, there are many just like that servant today. They have been given a talent, but because they do not have a proper relationship with Christ, they don't use their talent, but just hold on to it and do nothing with it. You know, I believe there are several reasons why this can happen. Number one, just like the servant, there are those who are just lazy. I mean, they're just lazy. They feel like they are owed something by God, or that the church is there to serve them instead of them being there to serve God in the church. They fail to understand that God created them and gifted them according to their ability to serve him in the local church and not the other way around. Listen to this. We owe God our devoted service because of what he has already given us in his son, Jesus. Now, the second thing I believe there are some who may have started well as faithful servants, but now they have grown apathetic or complacent, if you will. Maybe they have become distracted or discouraged, and it has caused them to lose focus of what is most important. And one thing we all know for sure, especially as we begin to come out of hopefully the worst of this pandemic, circumstances can definitely discourage us and distract us from what is most important. However, I also believe there is another group of people who love Jesus with all their heart and who serve him faithfully for many years. And because they have entered, listen to this, into their latter years of life, they think that their work for the Lord is done, or that they do not offer any more value to the kingdom. Well, let me offer you a word of encouragement. Do not think for a minute that God cannot still use you. In fact, I believe he still wants to use you. Your place of service may be a little different than before, but he still has a plan and a purpose for your life. One thing is for sure, we gain valuable experience and grow in godly wisdom over time as God's children if we are following him. And that valuable experience and wisdom you have gained from your walk with God desperately needs to be passed on to others, to the next generation, and so on, especially to those who are coming behind us. That is exactly what Paul talks about in Titus chapter 2. Plus, I believe with all my heart that when we have finished God's intended purpose here on this earth, he will call us home to heaven. So as long as we still have breath, he still desires to use us now. And if you are one of those this evening who may have grown a little complacent, if you will, or gotten discouraged or distracted in your service to God, or maybe have never put your God-given talents to work for him, then I encourage you to get busy. Get busy doing the work of the Lord. Jesus said in John 9:4, I must work the works of him who sent me while it is day. The night is coming when no man can work. We as God's children must always keep that same mindset, if you will, work until the time comes when no one can work. We must all, as God's children, continue diligently in the work of the kingdom with great urgency in light of the Savior's imminent return. And that leads me to the part of the parable of when the master returns and comes to settle accounts with his servants. You see, the two servants who were given the 5 talents and the 2 talents each came to the master and showed him how they each had gone and invested their talents that they had had been entrusted to them, and in turn gained 5 more and 2 more each respectively. And notice that when they gave an account before the master, you can sense a level of excitement as they showed the master what they had accomplished. They said to the master, look, we have gained more from what you had originally given us. There wasn't any shame there, but only confidence as they stood before their master. And the master then in turn commanded them. He said, because of their faithfulness, they were made ruler of over many things in the coming eternal kingdom. However, when the servant entrusted with the one talent came before the master, he said to the master, Lord, I knew you to be a hard man. That's interesting there. I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. And I was afraid and went and hid your talent in the ground. Look, there you have what is yours. In reading this, you don't sense the same level of excitement that the other two servants had when this servant presented the talent back to the master. I can only imagine that that his head may have been down as he spoke with a sense of dread. And then in verses 26 and 27, the master called this servant wicked and lazy and told him that he should have at least deposited the money with the banker so he would have gained some interest on the money before returning to the master. And in verse 28, the master directs that that his talent be taken from him and given to the servant who had 10 talents. But don't miss the importance of what Jesus mentions in the next verses 29 and 30. There is not only a coming judgment that every one of us will have to go through where we will have to answer for how we used our talents for his kingdom work, but there are also consequences. There will be eternal reward given to all who faithfully use the talents entrusted to them, and great eternal loss for the wicked and lazy, unprofitable servants. And this parable makes clear that when we appear before the judgment seat of Christ, there will be no excuses for why we didn't use our talents for the Lord. So in light of that, this parable should cause each one of us to be honest with ourselves, to see if we are using our talent or talents along with our God-given ability in faithful service to Christ. Whether it is our God-given skills or our God-given time or treasure, it is up to each one of us to be faithful in using them in faithful service to the kingdom of God. But as we close out our discussion of this parable, I don't want you to miss something important. How you view the master, which is Jesus, matters. And having the proper view of Jesus depends on whether you have a relationship with him or just a what we call a worldly knowledge of him. The two servants who invested their talents and ended up making more talents had a proper saving relationship with Jesus. The servant with only the one talent had only a worldly knowledge of Jesus. And that worldly knowledge of Jesus made him fearful of him. And as he said, he knew him only as a hard man and not as a loving father. Well, 1 John chapter 4, verses 15 through 18 says this, whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him and he in God. And we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love. And he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. And listen to this, love has been perfected among us in this, that we may have boldness in the day of judgment, because as he is, so are we in this world. There is no fear in love, but love, I say it again, but perfect love casts out fear. Because fear involves torment, but he who fears has not been made perfect in love. So we see from these verses that, yes, we are to have a reverence for God, but those who have a personal relationship with him do not have to live in fear of God. They can have a confident assurance when they stand before the Lord in judgment. Why? Because they have been led by the Holy Spirit, instead of by just worldly knowledge of Christ. So if you and I have a true born-again relationship, a true authentic relationship with Jesus, and are being led by the Holy Spirit of God, we should have no problem using the talents given to us along with our God-given ability for his glory and his kingdom purposes until he returns or calls us home. Well, I hope you all have enjoyed our discussion today about the parable of the talents. It has been a pleasure having the opportunity to share with you today. Next week, we will examine the parable of the 10 virgins together. I look forward to being able to share that with you next week. But before I let you go, I want to leave you with some questions for you to discuss amongst your family, your groups, or your friends. Number one, what is the difference in having a worldly knowledge of Jesus versus having a what we call a born-again relationship with Jesus? What is the difference in having a worldly knowledge of Jesus versus having a born-again relationship with Jesus? Number two, how does this parable motivate you in using your talent or talents for God? How are you currently using them now? Number three, how can you be confident and prepared when standing before Christ in judgment? And then number four, how can you encourage your fellow brothers and sisters to make sure they are actively using their talents for God? But before you discuss these questions together, I want to remind you again of a great resource that could benefit you as you examine the study of the parables of Jesus. It is Brother Ray's sermon series entitled The Stories of Jesus, and you will see a link below that you will be able to access those on the website. Again, thank you so much for tuning in, and I hope you have some wonderful discussion time tonight, and have a great week. God bless you.